are very wild, very angled, a lot of pivoting. And so I'm not sitting there saying I'm moving just like him right now, but the mentality of moving, getting inside and working the body and staying real close to people and using that power, that's where I feel like I'm going to be the best at.
Why boxing though? I mean, you could do any sport in the world. You did powerlifting. You could have done anything. You could do tennis, ping pong. You could do MMA. You could do basketball, soccer.
Probably the hardest sport I've ever done in my entire life.
It's true.
It's not. It's not just like power and how hard you hit. It's not just like the grit. There's so much mental game in boxing. And the more that I'm doing it, the more I'm like becoming even more obsessed with it because it's fucking hard. There's so many things that are going on, and you're in a chess match with this guy that he's trying to throw these punches, these angles. He's trying to maneuver on you. You're trying to do this, and so the difficulty of it is what's really driving me. And then obviously the naysayers of thinking that I'm not going to be capable of doing this thing. So you know,
haters are my motivators, as they say.
Motivators, man, and you know, and even then, I hope they eventually. We'll see, like, damn, he actually really did it.
So, speaking of which, obviously you have also, besides the haters, you have even more supporters. Who are some of the, like, the famous people that are inspired by you that say, wow, we're rooting for you, we're going for you?
Oh, man, I mean, I got a lot of, you know, of them in the, like, fitness industry, you know, like C.T. Fletcher, he's massive in the fitness industry. He's just a fucking motivator of life. I mean, the guy's story is crazy. You know, I just got off the phone with a guy named Stan Efferding who's actually training John Jones Bones right now. He's doing his nutrition and strength.
He loves boxing, man. Maybe you can spar.
Yeah.
Just be careful from his dog, because his dogs look pretty vicious now.
Yeah, his new dogs, yeah. So, you know, I got a lot of guys. You know, Terry Crews is a fan of me. So I got some pretty well-known, famous people that are fans of, like, what I'm doing. They understand, like...
Terry Crews is the actor and football player? Yeah. You know who wants to fight him in a celebrity fight?
Who's that?
Chris Arreola.
Oh, really?
He told me, I asked him yesterday, I said, Chris, who's your... Which celebrity
would I say? Terry just liked one of my photos the other day of me boxing, actually, the other day. So
that's amazing.
You know, and not just that, it's honestly, like, it's great to have, like, the famous people. But I truly like, today when I come in here and I meet some guys that are here from the UK, that they're like, dude, you're a fucking motivation. Holy shit. That means more to me than any famous person coming up to me and like, dude, I'm inspired by you. Because that's a legitimate kid right there. This is, like, what he's trying to do. And I'm motivating a kid that's basically a pro boxer. It's fucking crazy, right?
He's undefeated. The kid's gonna be a big champion.
That's what I'm saying.
He's 154, 21 years old, 6'3".
Big kid.
And he's a switch hitter like Crawford. He can fight orthodox.
And he comes out there, he's like, dude, you're just strictly motivation. That is more meaningful to me than anything. You know?
His name, I'm gonna put in the video there, Hamza Shiraz, by the way. He's a great kid. He was here with his dad. He's
got a lot of drive. Got a lot of drive.
So to end this interview, you've been dealing with this for a few years, I can imagine now.
What's that?
How many years?
Amputation. So I got blown up in April of 2010. I was in the hospital for 3 years, had over 40 surgeries. So it took me 3 years of surgeries and rehabilitation to just to get to be able to like live like a normal life, to like wake up, get, you know, have breakfast, go in a car and stuff like that. And then everything just kind of come now. So I've been at this now for about 10 years of just trying to change my life and put these obstacles in front of myself and trying to overcome little things that I put out in front of me.
Hey, you're not putting in little things. You're saying the biggest, toughest challenges out there. You didn't give up along any other way. You thought about it. You're like, no, I'm going to kind of... What kept you going when there was no... Like, okay, here, you're going to get a contract. You're going to fight professionally. You have something to look forward to, but you had nothing to look forward to. How were you able to keep going?
You know, I've had a lot of drive because of my daughter. When I got blown up, she was 2 months old. It started out as a little thing when I, you know, was learning after all my surgeries. She was getting to a point in her life where she was going to start walking. And I was at a point in my life where I was trying to learn how to walk. So here in my head, I'm trying to beat this newborn on how to walk. I'm a grown-ass man. And so it's just, I set the goal of, like, myself right there to beat her to walking. So, like, when she takes, I almost get emotional about it. So when she took her first steps, I was the dad taking her, there with her, doing her first steps. And, you know, I did it. That was a goal. And I made that goal. I took her first steps. She took her first steps and I was right there with her. And that's just kind of been it. And so, she's always been the one that, like, you know, she doesn't even know it yet. She's 11 now, but she's my drive. I want her to look back and be like, my dad did all this shit. And that's just kind of where it's at for me. Every single day, I talk to her every single day. You know, Rob, he'll be in the car with me, and we'll have her on speakerphone. And she's an amazing kid, and she truly looks up to me. And that's all I need right now.
Okay, if there was one fighter you could fight, who would you love to fight? Who would you like to get in the ring with?
Oh man, like legitimately. There's a couple, and it's mostly coming off of the sense of this Triller crap that just went down and the difficulty that, the potential difficulty that I could have of getting my pro card. So what was, Rob, what was the one guy's name, the billionaire?
Fournier.
What's his name?
Fournier.
Fournier, that guy, I feel like I could beat the brakes off that guy.
He has 13 fights.
And then, so the way he looked in Triller, he could come here and spar me in Los Angeles anytime he wants. And then Raycon. Raycon, I would beat with one hand behind tight behind my back, and I'd beat the dog piss out of him. The guy didn't even have the balls or the guts as a boxer to come out of the corner after just getting knocked on his ass at once. Dude, I got my leg blown off and I was getting my ass up. So if you can't come out of the corner, you're not a man. And you got your pro, you were able to get your pro card, but a guy like me, that's a legitimate fighter of life and a man, and with some cojones, you can knock me down as many times as you want, and I'm gonna go that corner, and if I can stand up on my own two legs and walk back out, I'm gonna. So those would be the two, because I just felt like I watched them. I'm like, wow, these guys got the opportunity, and you know, especially the Raycon guy. I mean, please hit me up if you want and let me whoop your ass, you know, because it's embarrassing, and it's an embarrassment to the sport, and I'm not trying to be like this cocky guy, but at the sense, it's like, I could possibly have difficulty of getting my pro card because of an amputation, but they'll give it to a guy like that.
To never train, never box.
Never
trained,
never did anything, and ran around the ring like he's scared. Like a kitten smacking a ball. And if they can give it to him, they can give it to me. And if not, then hey, Raycon, let me show them that I can box and box you. And then when I knock you down, I'll help you back up and we'll shake hands at the end.
Tell everybody where to follow you on Instagram.
Yeah, so my Instagram is that one leg monster. You actually use the number one, so that one leg monster. That's my Instagram. I have a small YouTube. I don't really post YouTube. Instagram is my main platform.
Yeah. There you have it. Make sure to follow Casey. Stay tuned and we'll keep you posted on his pro debut for YouTubePoint.com and Stickback Reporting. It's very, very inspiring. I mean, sometimes people wake up with someone minor, like just a twisted ankle or a headache, and their whole day's gone. But every day you're fighting, every day you're struggling, every day you're inspiring people because they watch you. If he could do it, I could do it.
That's the goal.
Now, you lifted 600 pounds.
Yeah.
How did you do it? How do you deadlift 600 pounds?
So, yeah, I deadlifted 600 and caught my best deadlift ever, 635 pounds. I've squat over 500 pounds. And
how do you practice lifting up cars?
Yeah, pretty much. You know, I train at a great gym in my hometown with a bunch of just...
Where are you from?
Bakersfield, California.
Oh, okay, of course.
And I train with a bunch of rural dogs out there, man, you know, and a lot of the people just knew I was trying to do it, and we just worked hard. I got a lot of great people that were behind me in that instant of powerlifting, nutrition, learning how to do a bunch of things, because I have to do things a little bit different, but... you know, all it was is repetitiveness and dedication and that whole like no excuse, no quit attitude that you have to wake up every single day and put in the work. Even guys that are just great athletes, to become great, they have to put in the work. You know, for example, let's talk boxing. Canelo doesn't just not go train and show up in the ring.
Hardest worker I know.
Guy works his ass off and he's the greatest. And if you're not the greatest, you got to work even harder to become the greatest. And that's just kind of like where I see myself every single day, is that I have to wake up. I have a disadvantage, obviously. I got to work harder to try to figure out how to make it not a disadvantage and make it an advantage for me, and that it works for me. So it's just a mentality. If you don't fucking have it, you ain't going to be the greatest. You're not going to be able to get to even a point of being successful in your goals in your life.
Casey, so a few questions. First of all, they say in boxing, everything starts from the legs, the power, yeah. The stance. How do you deal with that, given the way everything is?
It's doing it. You know, I do it. I'm a southpaw guy due to the
like
fact.
Pacquiao, yeah, like Lomachenko.
But I'm right-handed, but I'm southpaw due to this prosthetic. I'm able to put my legs back, and I'm able to drive. And me, because of like the from the powerlifting life, I've learned how to really use my hips. I really have to this mind muscle connection with my quads to where when I get ready to throw, I fire off my
quads. You transfer the power.
Transfer the power, and that's where it's at. I'm not here doing like the T-Rex punching. I'm throwing power. I'm not saying I'm the hardest hitter in boxing, but I hit just like any other boxer that would come in here with two legs.
Casey, if you're deadlifting 630 and you hit anything, you can hit a bull or a horse that's going down.
Yeah, I mean, that was the thing, you know, Rob, he's been coaching me, and that was like one of the first things that anytime I get around somebody and they watch me, that's one of the biggest things they say is like, that guy has a lot of power. And it is a big change for me to transfer that type of powerlifting, stiff type of powerlifting or a power to this real nice full extension, generating the power and pushing it all the way out, you know, from the legs to the body to the hands. And it's just repetitiveness. We're learning how to do it. Like I said, it's angles for me. It's a lot of just hip movement, and it's working and it's happening. And it's my leg isn't having me not be able to facilitate that type of movement.
But here's the crazy part: you could have worn long pants, and no one could have told.
Right.
We couldn't.
Yeah. So I tend to, back in the day, used to wear long pants. Because of that, I don't like the sympathetic bullshit. I don't want the sympathy. I knew what I was signing up to do. When I got blown up and I was going through everything, I understood this is what was meant to happen. I don't need the sympathy. I appreciate when people are like, hey, you know, thank you for your service and all that. Thank you. But I don't want sympathy. If I fall down, I trip, let me get up just like any other fucking man would, you know? And that's just the way it is. You know, when I go into the ring and I spar, I don't want sympathy spar partner. I want you to come in here and fight me like a fucking man. Because if you don't, I'm gonna beat your ass, you know? And that's just the mentality. I don't want any type of special treatment. And yeah, that's the goal, is to let people see like, wow, you move crazy. And then it should hopefully motivate other amputees in the world.
Absolutely. If you could do it, they could do it.
And
you're doing it to a whole nother level. It's one thing just to be in shape. It's another thing to want to fight. It's another thing to deadlift those kind of weights, which is not normal for anybody that doesn't have any health problems or issues or anything.
Yeah, that's the goal. It's not, I'm not doing this for, you know, let's just for example, that for like the Jake Paul fame. I'm doing this because I want to show people that it's capable of being done. Not just to everybody else, but to myself. I set a goal that I want to box, and I want to, you know, do a pro boxing, and I don't know how many fights I'm going to do. I know I want a bunch, you know, until I'm either tired of it or I can't do it anymore. You know, that's just where I'm at right now. And then, like I said, I just want to.
You're going to turn pro later this year. That's the
I'm
plan.
Hoping. That's the plan.
Who are some of your favorite fighters, Casey?
I'm a big Tyson, Mike Tyson fan. I, you know, was kind of growing up when he was fighting. I'm a real big Tyson Fury fan. Just his fucking mentality. But I have like this thing with Tyson Fury in the sense of he went through a very bad time of depression and just crazy stuff. And I had actually been there myself, where I had to get off the pills and I was depressed and I went through that, and so like his whole story and the comeback from that, it sits really deep with me. And now he's just this fucking bad man, and he's unstoppable right now. So those are a couple of mine. I love George Foreman, you know. Those are probably like the ones that I really try to like really look and almost kind of like want to mimic, especially like Mike Tyson, because I just feel like I'm kind of built like Mike Tyson. Obviously, Mike Tyson's legendary for the way he moves. Nobody moves
the speed,
like,
the hand, the head movement.
Nobody moves like that. But that's what we're trying to somewhat mimic with me. And if we can do that with like this, then hey, you know, there's no reason why anybody can't just get in there and box, you know.